Hello, everybody, and welcome to NPC Cast, your place for face-to-face games. My name is Chris, and I'm coming to you from sunny Seattle, Washington. And like I do every single week, I brought an NPC along for the ride with me to my right. Hailing from the frozen tundra of the north, he is NPC Del Del. How are you doing?
I'm not the only NPC here.
You aren't the only NPC. Well, you are the only NPC here.
Right, but we have a friend PC.
We do have a friend PC. This episode, we're going to be interviewing a friend of the show, Rodney Thompson, designer of games like Lords of Waterdeep. He worked on D&D 5e. He worked on Saga. He worked on a lot of different cool stuff for Wizards of the Coast. Now he's doing his own game called Dusk City Outlaws, and it's on Kickstarter right now. And we're going to talk to him all about his experiences at Wizards and about his new game, Dusk City Outlaws. This episode is brought to you by all the fine backers over at patreon.com/npccast. Patreon.com/npccast is where you can go to donate to the show if you feel so inclined. You want to toss us a couple bucks as a tip in advance for making videos like this and episodes like this, you can do that via patreon.com/npccast. We ready?
I'm ready. Let's get right into it.
All right, so let's bring Rodney on, and we're going to get into that right now. We are very happy to have our very first guest on NPC Cast 2.0, which is
second
a video
edition.
Version, the second edition. And that, of course, is designer of awesome games like Lords of Waterdeep, Tyrants of the Underdark.
Saga Edition.
Saga Edition. Also worked on 5th edition of a game called Dungeons & Dragons that you might have heard of. And he has a new Kickstarter that is on Kickstarter right now called Dusk City Outlaws. We're very, very happy to welcome to the show Mr. Rodney Thompson. How are you doing, Rodney?
I am doing great, guys. Thanks for having me.
So we met back in the day. We did something called Tabletop Deathmatch.
Yeah, about 4 years ago, I think. Almost five.
Yeah, and you've been pretty busy since then.
I have stayed busy, you know. Yeah, it's also 5 years ago. Let's see here. I was still at Wizards at the time, and we were right in the middle of working on D&D 5th edition. And then we finished up that, and then I did Tyrants of the Underdark. And then I left Wizards after almost a decade, and now I work at Bungie on the Destiny franchise.
Oh, that's awesome. I actually didn't even know that you were working on Destiny.
What? Yeah, I've been there almost 2 years now.
So let's go back to your days at Wizards, because I want to kind of speak to you about this, because we don't oftentimes have someone who is on the show that's done, you know, the role playing games, done the tabletop games, and sort of in my eyes has found success doing both. And I think it's fair to say that the games that you have worked on have been critical successes and mainstream successes as well. You know, Lords of Waterdeep being one of the quintessential worker placement games, I think, of our time, you know. So let's kind of talk about your time at Wizards. How did you get your start there, and sort of where did you begin with Wizards of the Coast?
So I freelanced for about 6 years. I started in 2001 freelancing for Wizards for the Star Wars role-playing game, the revised edition, the D20 edition that they'd done back then. And then I freelanced for about 6 years for Wizards, for Green Ronin, for Paizo, for a bunch of different companies, West End Games, which still existed at the time. And then in 2006, I worked with Chris Perkins and Owen Stevens to create the Star Wars Saga Edition core rulebook. And I was still a freelancer at the time. And then they were like, okay, we're gonna relaunch the product line once this is done. So they hired me to be the lead designer for Saga Edition. And so I came in, I ran that product line for its entire duration. And then once the Star Wars license lapsed, they moved me over to D&D.
So gotcha. whose idea was it, Rodney, to make square books?
That actually, that was a decision that was made before I got hired. I don't know who to lay whose feet to lay that at. You know, it's one of those things that a lot of people are like, oh, this is really weird. Why would you do this? But then I get a lot of people that are like, yeah, it's great because it sits open so well. Like, it actually can have it open at the table and it works really well. Yeah, I like it because I can always find them on my shelf, right?
Yeah, I don't hate it at all. It's an interesting design decision, and it makes them visually pop really well. It was just an interesting way to do that.
Yeah, there was a real drive for a while there in our production teams at Wizards to try and find ways to visually distinguish games because, you know, you're always competing for shelf space and stuff like that. And so that was one of those on the RPG. And then, like, the Lords of Waterdeep box, I mean, I'm sure you guys know, like, you look at that on its side, it's really different from any other board game. So, you know, they're always those designers are always looking for a chance to do something a little bit different so that it stands out. And I think that's cool that they experiment like that.
So did you come from just like a writing background or a game design background when you were doing freelance for Wizards? What sort of projects were you kind of starting with? Was it just like, hey, I can write some fiction for you, or I can do some game design for you?
It was game design. What had happened was in 1998, when I was but a wee high school student, I was running a Star Wars D6 Star Wars game, and I had a whole bunch of notes from this like 2-year-long campaign, and I uploaded it to my university website so that I didn't have to take all my notes with me in physical form. I just like I knew HTML, which was magical at the time, and, so I put that up, and people started finding it through the web because there wasn't a lot of stuff up at the time, and started sending me emails, and then I converted my university account and into like a real Star Wars fan site, and then that kind of blew up, and for a while there I was running one of the biggest Star Wars RPG fan sites on the internet, and did that for a long time, and Wizards came across the work that I was doing on that, and they're like, hey, you're putting out daily RPG content. Like, literally every day I had a new stat block or something that I was putting out, and that's what they gave me that shot. So from the beginning, the very first thing I worked on for them was the Heroes Guide for the Star Wars Revised system, which introduced a bunch of new classes and prestige classes and random like organizations and stuff like that. It was kind of a hodgepodge player supplement. And so from there forward, I was working on RPG design for Wizards and, like I said, Green Ronin and Paizo, etc.
That's an awesome story because that's like, you know, nowadays with the way the social media is and like blogging is and the fact that anyone can, you know, publish content to, you know, their own blog. Your story is sort of mirrors that, but it's just kind of before these platforms became readily accessible to everybody.
It's true. And, you know, the thing was that they were looking for someone who could consistently produce that content with like regularity, and I think what it showed them was that like not only did I have a lot of ideas and creativity, but also I had the discipline to like make sure that every day I was putting something out, because that's what it was I had set myself a goal of every day there's going to be new content coming out, and I had established a good relationship with them because I was trying to be like a, you know, the premier Star Wars RPG news site, right? They were seeing that I was sticking to that schedule, and you're always looking for that regularity and that ability to adhere to whatever schedules you've set up, because I mean 50% of being a good freelancer is just doing your work, right?
Yeah, it's really awesome, because I think that like you are sort of that success story of that person who was making content out of the love of creating the content and then was like kind of discovered. And again, I think it's really interesting because, you know, when you're like nowadays, that's the same formula that people, you know, that come to me and say like, hey, you know, I want to get into the industry. I'm like, well, just start putting stuff out. I mean, we talked last week about starting this show was a way for us to produce regular content because we wanted to give back to the community and be involved in the community.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, that I think we're in a really great time period right now because it is easy or it's easier, I would say, for people to put out content that they create and put their creativity on display and really show what kind of chops they have for design or show hosting or whatever it might be. There's more venues than ever before. It is both easier and harder in some ways to get other people to see your content. Easier because it's easier to make it accessible, harder because there's more of it out there. So, you know, it's a little bit different, but yeah, like it's awesome. And, you know, now that I am starting to do my own stuff for my own little company that I've created, I'm learning kind of what a lot of people have been doing, or what a lot of other people have already learned. Like I'm now learning lessons that I kind of missed because I was working at Wizards for 10 years during this rapid growth of internet accessibility for RPG creativity, right? And so now I'm like, oh God, how do I get people to know about my game and play my game, right? Like that's all new to me, and that's been, what's the right word for a combination of challenging and terrifying? That's the feeling.
I think terrifying.
Terrifying.
I think we're what we're going to go with. So So you get a chance to produce content for Wizards and go there and start doing some freelance stuff, and you know you're consistent, and then they bring you on to sort of lead design Saga, and then at what point do you transition to starting to work on the other IPs with that in Wizards?
So I worked on some D&D 4th edition source books. I didn't work on the core books other than, like, you know, playtesting and stuff, because that was, everyone was playtesting, right? Mm-hmm. But once they started getting into the source books for 4th edition D&D, I started working on development teams. Just, you know, one book every, I don't remember, quarter, I guess you would say, right? And I was a developer on those. And then over time, that workload just started shifting more and more towards D&D and away from Star Wars. And so I started, you know, leaning on my freelancers more, which was great because I had a suite of freelancers that I had kind of been able to work with consistently, and they had gotten used to what I expected. They had, I mean, you know, not just writers, but also editors, and they were able to take on a larger portion of the design work there. But so I shifted over to working on D&D supplements for 4th edition, and around the time that the Star Wars license lapsed and we put the last book out, that was when I started working full time on D&D. And I think that was right in the middle of like the 4th edition life cycle. So I think, if I'm not mistaken, the first project that I worked on that I had a major responsibility for was the Dark Sun setting for 4th edition.
Ooh, it was real good.
Thank you. I was the lead developer for that. And so I ran the development team for both the core book and the monster book, right? I think that was the first thing I worked on post-Star Wars that I was sort of given the reins of responsibility on. And then from there, you know, I led the design of several books. Heroes of the Feywild is one that I got to lead design on, and I was pretty happy with that one. And then when we started working on 5th edition D&D, from the very beginning, I was involved in the design of that with, you know, Mike and Jeremy and those guys. And, you know, some of the earliest prototypes, things that never even saw the light of day well before the public playtest, I was working on those, like, after having transitioned off of Star Wars.
When you were coming into Dungeons & Dragons, were you as big of a fan of sort of the catalog and the history of Dungeons & Dragons as you were with, like, Star Wars? Because to me, I think it's interesting that you started with, like, a, you know, IP that was sort of has a cult following, and then transitioned into writing for another IP that has a very big cult following. Was that something that you've kind of always embraced? Were you a D&D fan and also a Star Wars fan, you know, kind of simultaneously?
Well, with Star Wars, I was deep down the rabbit hole on Star Wars. Like, I was consuming everything, every book, every comic, every video game, everything, and mostly with an eye towards the RPG, because what I really loved was the Star Wars RPG. I love the movies and everything too, right? But I would read comics and then immediately go home and be like, here are the stats for that starship and that comic, right?
Yeah.
And it was kind of the same with D&D, that I was in love with the game, and the setting stuff was just sort of like the venue through which I would filter that love, right? But the difference between D&D and Star Wars is that with D&D, you put so much of your own creativity into it. I mean, so many people run their own campaign settings and their own adventures and stuff like that, that I didn't have the deep well of lore knowledge for certain aspects of it. Like, I just have blind spots, right? Like, I know almost nothing about Dragonlance, for example. Mm-hmm. But I can tell you almost everything that is in every single source book for Al-Qadim.
Wow! Rodney bringing the deep cuts.
Oh, I love Al-Qadim. Al-Qadim is by far my favorite D&D campaign setting. But so, like, Al-Qadim and Dark Sun, I know a lot about those, but like Dragonlance, like, know nothing about it, right? Mm-hmm. Actual real Greyhawk, I didn't know very much about that until we started the 5th edition process, and I started running a Greyhawk campaign for my own personal, like, home playtest group. So it's weird. I have these, like, gaps in my lore knowledge, but when it comes to game mechanic stuff, like, I know all that stuff. So I can tell you what this kit was in this second edition, you know, complete elves handbook or whatever. But when it comes to, like, what's the lore of this character in this setting, it was sort of hit or miss, right? Whereas with Star Wars, everything I was consuming became fodder for my own sort of creative stuff, right? Because I had that website, right? And yeah. I was putting out stuff all the time. So I knew more about Star Wars lore, but when it came to the love of the game, I would say, like, you know, D&D is it's a huge part of who I am, right? Like, I met lifelong friends through D&D.
Yeah. Yeah. And this is going to be fascinating when we get to your newest project, Dusk City Outlaws, because this is the first project that you've gotten to work on where you're doing both, like, the entire backstory mm-hmm. is like your baby, and then also the game design is you.
Yeah.
But before we get to that point, I do want to talk about the transition to Lords of Waterdeep and, you know, Tyrants of the Underdark, too. Like, you know, two very solid board games that I think, to be completely honest, changed my perception of board games based on, like, existing, you know, IPs, and, like, especially role-playing IPs. I think both of those games stand on their own and then also happen to be Dungeons & Dragons games, which is very hard to do with a popular IP like Dungeons & Dragons. Mm-hmm. So how did you get involved in that process, and sort of, did they approach you? Did you say, hey, I want to do a board game? Like, how did that work?
So at Wizards at the time, and I'm pretty sure it's still this way, but I haven't been there for a couple of years, everybody was all in, like, one big pit area, right? Like, we were all sat near each other. And Peter Lee, who had been working on the Adventure System board games, and I had just been talking, and I was like, hey, you know, I'd love to do a worker placement game someday. And he was like, yeah, I've got this idea for a system that's basically like quests, right? And it was just sort of the two of us got to talking, and then I made a prototype, or a design document, I should say, for the game when I was on a train going from Seattle to Chicago for Gen Con.
Game train.
The game train, that's right.
Yeah.
Which I hope to resurrect someday. But
Invite me.
Yes.
I've always, like, we keep talking about wanting to do it, and we never pull the trigger, but we need someone like you to, like, you know, lead the charge.
Well, my wife is about to have our first kid, so it won't be this year.
Oh, wow. Well, congratulations. That's awesome.
Oh, thank you. But yeah, so I created that design document, and I brought it back to Pete, and we put together a prototype, and it just kind of had this magic from day one. Like, the very first prototype was fun, which almost never happens, honestly. But it was fun, and it kind of came out of nothing. And when I say we willed it into existence, that really kind of how it worked, right? Like, we worked on it during our lunch breaks, and we would go to this cafeteria in a building, like, across the street that was like a health insurance provider company, and we'd go to their cafeteria and sit and talk about the game and everything. And it wasn't really until the game was at a point where you would say it's, like, ready to hand off to development that we finally showed it to, like, my manager and got that kind of traction. And it was great because I could sit people down and they'd play the game and they'd be like, okay, how do we make this happen? I'll be like, well, I'll tell you. Yeah. First, we figure out how to make it happen.
Yeah.
And so it kind of came organically, but we were already making board games at the time. Like, at that point, I think Pete had already done the first two Adventure System games and Conquest of Nerath. Those had come out. And then we did Lords of Waterdeep, and that was about a 13-month process that was awesome. And I was kind of doing that while we were also working on D&D stuff. And then we also did, in between Lords of Waterdeep and Tyrants, we also did Dungeon Command, which was a tactical miniatures game that was card-driven. Mm-hmm. And let me tell you, if anyone asks me what is your favorite game to design content for, Dungeon Command always enters the conversation, because that game was just super fun to create, like, cards and stuff for, right? But we did Dungeon Command, which didn't gain a ton of traction. I think it's because of the nature of the miniatures market at the time, honestly.
Right.
And also, like, the sort of format and everything. And then with Tyrants kind of came about the same way that Lords of Waterdeep did, in that, you know, Pete and I were just sitting around saying, like, you know, I said, I want to make a strategy game. Like, we made a tactical game, like a super tactical game in Lords of Waterdeep. Let's make a more strategic game. And he was like, okay, I want to make a game that uses deck building as a mechanic, not as the end goal. Not like your deck is what wins, but it's more like your deck lets you do the thing that you need to do to win. And so that's sort of where that came from. And again, we just sort of worked on it on the side and eventually got to the point where we could show it to people and finally, you know, showed it to the right people. And they were like, yep, okay, let's make this game. So board games were definitely, like, there was no... like, I had my responsibilities on the RPG, and so did Pete, for that matter. Like, he was also working on 5th edition with me at the time. It was one of those deals where it was like, okay, let's get a game made by making a good game first, right? And yeah. That, you know, that makes it a lot easier to sell somebody when you can sit them down and say, like, here's the game, come play it, and help me make it a reality.
Yeah, it's still awesome, though, to hear that, like, that was, you know, embraced by the people at Wizards of the Coast. Because, you know, like, when you imagine the way, like, a you know, a tight-knit game studio works. That's how you would imagine it. But obviously, when people think of Wizards of the Coast, they think of, like, this huge, you know, like, Goliath. And to hear about this idea of, like, you know, two designers who, on their lunch breaks, designed a game, and then eventually that game got, you know, made and was successful, and that's what happened. Like, that's a pretty cool story, I think.
Well, you know, even Wizards, right, even Titanic Wizards, they're just people, right? Like, they're people who make games, and...
And Gleemax.
And Gleemax, which shall never be spoken of again. but, you know, like... RPG R&D was not huge, right? And still isn't huge. In fact, it's smaller than when I was there, right? So it definitely, you know, the people working on Dungeons & Dragons are a tight-knit community of people who love D&D, so there's a lot more intimacy when it comes to, like, selling other people on the idea of the game, because you're sitting next to them all day long. It's not like, you know, I had to, okay, we put together our prototype, and then we, you know, fly to a remote location, or, you know, march upstairs to the executive suite or anything. It was like, no, I turn around to the guy behind me, I'm like, hey boss, you want to play my new game, and hopefully we make it. So it's not exactly what you imagine when you imagine the monolithic corporate Wizards of the Coast. It's not really a thing.
Yeah, so that's awesome.
So let's go from monolith to one man operation.
Tell us
about Dusk City.
Well, you know, I've been working in the games industry for about 15 years now, and everything I've ever worked on has been someone else's IP or game or project. You know, even like Lords of Waterdeep that I say we willed into existence, that's the D&D IP, right? That's somebody else's stuff. And I've never gotten to make anything that was both my own game and my own IP and that I got to call the shots on. And so now that I work at Bungie, I can do stuff like this on the side. And it was like, okay, I want to make something that's wholly my own. I want to come up with something on my own. And also, like, I want to make a game that I want to play. Like, the best games that I've made so far are games that I like playing still. Like, I still play Lords of Waterdeep, right? So I came up with the idea to do this thing, and I'm like, okay, what am I going to do? Well, I've got this dice system that I've been noodling on for a while, and boy, I sure would like to do a role-playing game that comes in a board game form factor and is as easy to get on the table as a board game, right? And I had these kind of goals, and there was two or three different goals, and like the nascent idea for the setting is something I'd been rolling around in my head for a while. I had a really great experience with Legend of the Five Rings a few years back, and I was like, man, I'd really like to do something that has factions that are as cool and vivid as the clans in L5R. And that all sort of came together last year, like around last March or so, and I was like, okay, I think I want to try and make a game here, right? I want to try and do something of my own, and so I started designing the game, right? Because that's what I know how to do. I know how to design a game, right? Kind of. I started designing the game, and the first design documents came together, and we started playtesting, and over the course of about I would say about 8 months of really good serious design and testing and iteration, I got to the point where I was like, okay, this game is like 90% done, and I decided to go ahead and try and make it a real boy. I'm trying to make it a real game, and so now I'm kickstarting my game, which has gone from random hodgepodge of ideas and a goal to make my own thing to, holy cow, like humans might actually play my game out in the wilderness.
Yeah. So we talked about it a little bit on last week's episode. I don't know if you've ever heard our show, but at the end of the show, we always talk about...
I try not to pay attention to you guys if I can.
Yeah, that's understandable. Understandable.
But
we talked about what we're excited about, and that was what I was excited about this week. I've already backed the Kickstarter. But to the people who are just tuning in now, or, you know, maybe, you know, found this through Twitter or whatever, tell them kind of the elevator pitch for the game. Because I was hooked with the elevator pitch, and I think a lot of people will be too.
Yeah. So the game is a fantasy heist criminal game, right? It is a game where you play a band of criminals drawn from these eight sort of vivid, colorful cartels that come together to form a crew and are given a job. And that job is like, you know, rob a bank or break this guy out of jail or rob this armored gondola. It's all some kind of criminal endeavor, right? And what the players do is the players come up with a plan and they go out in the city, they do the legwork to get everything set up, and then they pull off that plan, right? It is a sandboxy game that comes, like I said, in a board game form factor. And the reason I wanted to do that is because I wanted it to be a game that if it's the spur of the moment and you're like, I want to play an RPG tonight, but I haven't done any prep in advance. Like, what can we play? Well, let's play Dusk City Outlaws. So you pull it off the shelf. One person who's going to be the judge, which is like the game master, they start reading the scenario. The other players make their characters by picking from two sets of character cards and putting them together. It's sort of a pick two combination character creation style. Mm-hmm. And then that takes about, you know, 10-15 minutes for everybody to get situated and figure out who your characters are. And then you can start playing. And because it is a sandbox where there's no right or wrong way to do it, the players drive a lot of the action. The players come up with their own plan. The players define the scenes that they're going to take part in. So like, oh, hey, you know, we're going to rob this bank, but we want to make sure that the head of security is sick that day, so I'm going to go break into his house and poison him so that he's out of work for the next week or something like that, right? And so you sort of identify your obstacles, and then you go take those obstacles out or set things up so that you can take them out while the heist or whatever is going on. And so the players drive a lot of the action. The judge is just sort of responding to those things with the information that was in the scenario. And the game's got sort of two big mechanics that I think make it easy to run on the fly, in addition to like character creation and the pre-made scenarios. One of those is I've got a narrative dice system in the game, which is I call it my spiritual riff on the Fantasy Flight Star Wars dice system, right?
That is my favorite dice system in any game ever.
So that's awesome. Yeah.
You're on the right track.
Yeah. So, like, I really like what that does with making, like, every roll a chance for a whole spectrum of results and, like, you sort of creatively interpret it. And I wanted to do something like that, but I had some kind of different goals in mind that that exact system wouldn't necessarily pull off. So I wanted something that was a little bit more streamlined, so it was a little bit faster to resolve. I wanted something that was easy for someone to sort of look at their character and know not only what are they good at, but how good are you at it. And then I wanted to make sure that once you rolled the dice, that the interpretation process was pretty simple and like keep the pacing moving forward. Because in like a game that's really player driven, it's easy for the pace to lag. So I didn't mm-hmm. want that to happen, right? So the way the dice system works is it's percentile dice for success and failure. And if you are going to do a thing, you have a skill for it. It's like, oh, I've got shoot someone on my sheet at 80%. You always, no matter who you're shooting, always have an 80% chance to hit them, right? Like that doesn't change. So if you see 80% shoot somebody on your sheet, you know exactly how good you are at it. In any given situation, you know how likely you are to succeed. But to cover like positive and negative circumstances that are outside of just like your normal chance of success, we've got advantage and challenge dice. And these are symbol-based dice. They don't have any numbers on them. And every time you add an advantage die or challenge die to the roll, it represents like a positive or negative circumstance. So like, okay, you're going to shoot the guy, you got an 80% chance of success, but it's dark outside and it's raining, so I'm going to give you two challenge dice, but he doesn't know you're there, so I'm going to give you one advantage die. So you form this die pool, you roll all the dice together. The percentile dice are binary success fail. The advantage and challenge dice are sort of upside and downside. So you can have like failure, but with an upside. So like, yeah. Oh yeah, you missed the guy, but you know he's so spooked that he falls into the canal or something like that, right? And so it gives you like this spectrum of results with really just a very simple additional, like, you know, every upside you add another die, every downside you add another die, and boom, you go, right? So it's really fast. And what that does is it takes away the need for a lot of prep work on the part of the judge to like, okay, what are going to be the dramatic tension moments here? Like, no, it just comes out during play, right? Like you play and like, oh wow, you failed a roll and you rolled three drawbacks as well. Well, something real bad's going to happen. And then you just sort of introduce it on the fly, right?
Mm-hmm.
Kind of, I mean, again, you see sort of the echoes of the like Fantasy Flight Star Wars, the Warhammer Fantasy, or games like, you know, that, but in a, I would call it a streamlined form, right?
Yeah, now, I actually like the addition of having the sort of the binary pass-fail there as well, because like at a glance, like you said, you can tell how good you are at something.
Yeah.
It's a little bit more nebulous to kind of be like, okay, like what are my actual chances to, you know, get a hit when I'm doing the Star Wars dice? So I like, you know, combining those things. Something that we've found, though, in running Star Wars is that oftentimes, you know, the players, when they kind of roll the dice and they see, you know, the outcome of the die roll, they're not always sure what to do with that. So have you found, like, in your playtest and on your writing, are there sort of tips or techniques that you have for sort of interpreting these things? Is there like a kind of a chart or something that you can look at?
Kind of, yeah. So basically what I do is I say that, okay, when you roll the dice, you look at your results, and then the judge is sort of the arbiter of what happens based on those dice. But there's sort of two things to help with that. One is, yeah, there's a chart that's like, here are, I think it's like 8 or 10 sample things that could happen from drawbacks and from advantages. And some of them are really simple, and they're just like, yeah, you generate some extra heat, or you take a little bit of damage, or whatever, and then you do and put a narrative wrapper around that. And then, of course, there's the, have you played this game a bunch, and you're pretty good at improvising things? Well, go nuts. Like, here's the severity, right? Like, three drawbacks is worse than one drawback, right? Right. And so there's some improvisation there. And the other side of it is, I instruct the judge to put a lot of that back on the players with a prompt, right? So like, okay, yeah, you're going to generate some heat, which means that the city notices you, or you draw some unwanted attention, right? Why don't you tell me what happened when you were doing that drew unexpected attention, or something like that? So that it is a combination judge and player effort, and it doesn't leave anybody with the sole responsibility of deciding things, right? Yeah, I mean, like, it was something that I knew was going to be a necessity right away, because I think typically, like, when you're the judge or game master player, you are used to having a lot of that responsibility, but players aren't. But in a game that I'm trying to do low prep work, I can't put everything on the judge, because then you're just going to feel unprepared all the time, and that's the exact opposite of what I wanted. So it was like, okay, I'm going to meet you halfway. Judge is the final arbiter, but here's how you prompt the players to get them to, you know, help you with this narrative, right? And then sometimes, like, now that I'm more experienced with my own game, like, I was running a situation the other night where a player tried to snatch an ammo pouch off the belt of one of the secret police in the city, and he rolled a bunch of drawbacks. And I was like, okay, you snatch the ammo pouch, but he takes a swipe at you with his sword, and you lose, you know, take 30 damage or whatever, right? And, like, that was just something that, like, it just became instantaneous. I didn't need to put it back on the player or anything. It's like, okay, this makes sense, right? And also, like, that's a cool cinematic moment, right? Like, yeah, you grab the pouch, but then he swipes at you, and you tuck and roll out of the way. And, you know, you're used to game, like, I'm used to games like D&D, where to resolve that narrative situation would have been like, okay, he makes an opportunity attack. Do you have this meat? Right. Like, okay, let's not get into that. So it's definitely more put a narrative wrapper around really simple mechanics.
Gotcha. So when we sit down to the table, I volunteer to be the judge. I'm going to run
volunteer's tribute. Yep.
Yep. What am I doing to prepare for the session? I mean, like, I'm going to read a little thing and say, okay, here's the basic outline. What else do I have to do to prepare?
That is the bulk of it, right? So what you do is, and when I say that you can pull it off the shelf and start playing in 10 minutes, I assume everybody has read the rules or something like
sure,
that.
Yeah,
if you haven't read the rules, add X amount of time to learn the rules. It's like a board game, right? I don't expect you to play Agricola in 2 hours if you've never played before, right? So if you're the judge, what you do is you pull the thing off the shelf, you hand out all the character materials to the players and let them go nuts, right? Then you pick a scenario, and the scenarios, they range in time to play from about 2 hours is about the shortest one I have right now, up to something that you would play over 2 to 3 4-hour sessions. Sorry, don't want to oversell it too much, right?
No.
And all you do is you pick a scenario and you open it up and you just read, and it's usually like 2 to 4 pages of information that is all the basic premise of the heist or the con or the job or whatever, right? So you're going to rob this jewelry store. You're going to break this guy out of prison or whatever. And then it's all of the obstacles that get in the way of that being easy, or information about, like, elements of that, you know, that job, right? So it's like, okay, you're going to break you out of prison. Here's information about the guy. Here's information about the prison. Here's information about the captain of the watch that runs the prison. Here's the information about the two bounty hunters that brought the guy in and that are waiting outside to collect their bounty, right? Like, all these different basic elements that are just, like, here's what's true about the things that make you pulling off your job difficult. But the other key is, every single one of those elements not only has here's what's true, it also has here's what's exploitable, or here's what's the weakness, right? And what the players are going to be doing is they're going to be trying to find those exploitable things in the different parts of the obstacles, right? Mm-hmm. And counteracting those obstacles using those exploits. So all you're doing is reading, and once you've sort of vaguely familiarized yourself with everything, you don't have to get super in-depth, but it's not a ton of information. At that point, you're ready to go. And so everything then goes back onto the players, because the players come up with their plan. The players then start defining their legwork scenes. And the game's divided into daytime and nighttime. And during daytime or nighttime, you can do planning, where you all have like the iconic cinematic moment where everyone's sitting around the table, like, you know, looking at the blueprints of the bank or whatever, right?
Yeah.
Or you do legwork. And the way legwork works is you say, here's what I want to get out of the scene. I want to poison this guy. I want to steal these plans. I want to infiltrate the bank or whatever. You describe how you're going to do it. I'm going to steal the plans by breaking into the architect's office and stealing them, right? And then I would, as the judge, you just describe the obstacles, either what's laid out in the scenario, or you can then spend heat, which is that resource that the players are generating for committing crimes, to introduce new complications. Like, okay, yeah, you're going to go to the architect's office and you're going to break in at night and you're going to steal it. That's great. When you get there, you find out this architect, he's got a crown contract, so there are city watch guarding the office, and you're not able to get, like, and so basically, like, okay, here's an obstacle, and then it's back on the players to, like, come together as a group and deal with those obstacles so that you can then steal the plans and continue putting your plan into motion. And so at that point, really all you're doing when you run the game is reacting to what the players do and, you know, helping them out, because some players are more comfortable with others driving the action. So there's a lot of, like, prompt the players to, you know, describe their plan more in depth or describe the situation more in depth and, you know, kind of running the NPCs and stuff like that. At that point, it becomes very much like a traditional RPG, right?
Mm-hmm.
So how much of this game can be used in a campaign setting rather than just one-offs?
All that I put out right now, if you back the game right now on Kickstarter, you can access the print and play, which is just a one-off, right? It's like one scenario. But what's not included in that packet is the campaign rules, which I'm working on now. And the way the campaign play works is campaign play isn't necessarily focused on your character getting stronger or more powerful, because I kind of already assume that you're a badass, right? Like, you're already the grifter or the assassin or the brawler, right? That's already who you are. What instead matters is the relationships that you build up with NPCs and conflicts. So what you're tracking is recurring NPCs and recurring conflicts. And every time one of these things appears in a session, and like both judge and players have the ability to bring them in, they have a bigger and bigger impact every time, right?
I love this.
Yeah, that's sort of represented by, like, okay, like, I watched a lot of Leverage when I was working on this game.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you guys have watched Leverage, you know there's the other insurance adjuster who,
yep,
I always think of as Badger from Firefly, but he's actually, oh crap, I can't remember his name.
I don't remember his name either. I'm watching it again for the second time, too.
Oh,
and I love
that show. Anyways, so every time he shows up, like, he has a bigger and bigger impact. And that's sort of what I realized is, like, in episodic TV shows, they can have episodes that feel like they have good, solid resolution, but then have a through line that moves through multiple episodes with characters or conflicts or storylines. And so what I'm doing is basically campaign play says, you know, at the end of a session, you as players can say, like, okay, we thought that this character or this conflict was really interesting and we want this to continue forward, so we're going to add that to our campaign sheet, right? And then every time it shows up, you basically fill in another box on that sheet that says, like, okay, this NPC has showed up 4 times. Now he's this tier of NPC, right?
Hmm.
Which means that he has a bigger impact on the game every time he shows up. Like, if he's helping you, he gives you a bunch of advantage dice. If he's hindering you, maybe now instead of just being like a low-level antagonist, now he's a minor villain, etc. And then conflicts kind of work the same way. And I define them loosely as conflicts because they originally started out as like the war between the different factions, right? Like, okay, well, you know, you have a bunch of XP or respect or whatever with the mummers, but the Red Lotus Society hates you or whatever. And then I realized what's more compelling about that is not that the Red Lotus Society hates you and the mummers love you or vice versa. What's actually interesting about that is the conflict between your crew in that faction or those two factions, right? Because what can happen is you might say, like, okay, I'm a member of the mummers, right? And I had this run-in with the Red Lotus Society that was really bad. We're going to write mummers versus Red Lotus Society down as the conflict. But then if another player decides to later make, like, a Red Lotus character, they can still join the crew and benefit from that conflict being a part of the campaign, as opposed to being like, we hate those guys. That's not really a good thing. We don't want you in our crew, right? It gives, like, I think it gives a lot more interesting moments, because, like, now all of a sudden, maybe two members of the same crew are plugging into this conflict from different angles. We both want it to come into play, but, you know when it's going to come into play, it's going to have a bigger and bigger impact, right? And the conflict doesn't have to be, like, organization versus organization. It can be, like, us versus the city watch, or we are now wanted criminals, so the conflict is us versus the bounty that's been put out on our heads, right? Like, these are all like moments of conflict, interesting points that could come back over and over and over again. So, like, the bounty's being put out on you is a great example, right? If we decide that that's an interesting conflict, the bounty on the crew, then every time we deal with a situation where the bounty on our heads comes into play, like, it has a bigger and bigger impact throughout the campaign.
That is really cool.
Yeah, that sounds awesome. So I'm a really big fan of this idea of taking, like, shows like Leverage, because, like I said, I'm watching it again for the second time.
Yeah.
The first time I was, like, really focused. This is more of, like, I'm working, it's on the background, and then I find myself paying more attention to it than I should.
Right.
but I really do enjoy that sort of genre of show, and I love the idea of bringing this sort of Ocean's 11 style heist type vibe to a fantasy setting. I think that's really cool. I love the idea of, like, urban fantasy. We played a little bit of Iron Kingdoms, and it's kind of like,
oh, yeah,
we played in the urban setting, kind of the same thing. This is, you know, your first, you know, published game that you're creating the mechanics and the setting for it. And you talked a fair amount about the mechanics.
Yeah.
But what is it that excites you about this genre of fiction? And what is it that excites you about the setting that you're able to create for this game?
I think that the part of the setting that I'm the most excited about, it's kind of a giant setting, right? Like, it's intentionally, I use the New York analog, and really it's the Hollywood New York analog, right? It's the idea that, like, there could be infinity stories going on in the city at the same time, right? So that it's like the setting is just the city. There is no, like, I don't care about anything outside of the city, right? Like, that's the setting. But what's really exciting to me is the eight cartels, the eight different factions, because they add so much character to the characters in a lot of ways. I'm working with a character designer. Her name is Joy Ang, and Joy is the character designer for Adventure Time on Cartoon Network, and she also paints title cards for it. So Joy is super, super talented, and she's helped me create sort of visual styles for these different factions that I think they evoke real-world criminal cartels or criminal organizations, but it goes through a filter, right? That goes through the game filter. And then they also have their own sort of unique take and unique spin. And what's really interesting to me is that when you make a character, 50% of your character is which cartel you are. And that's going to flavor everything from, like, how you view the job that you're doing, to what kind of resources you can call upon, to, like, what kind of conflicts you're in. Like, I'm really good at dealing with nobles, so when we go talk to the noble, like, even though I'm not the grifter, maybe you want to bring me along to help, right? And so I think that just like in, like, Legend of the Five Rings or any other game where your faction or clan or whatever is really important, it's going to be the same way in my setting, right? Because when you come to the table, everything's going to be about, like, oh, I'm a mummer or a warden of the night or whatever, and that sets the tone for how I approach the entire job. I think there's also a ton of really interesting storytelling potential there, because, you know, these factions are technically they have a truce between them that is like, hey, we're not going to go into any open gang warfare. That way we can all work together on jobs and we can all get rich. But there's still a little bit of conflict and a little squabbling that goes on. And one of the things I'm working on for the Kickstarter still that's, you know, in process, and I say in process because we'll see how well the Kickstarter does and maybe this gets bigger than it is right now, is a set of rules for what I call, like, turf war. And the idea is that, like, okay, this really is about, like, all right, now instead of playing a bunch of different characters from different factions, we're going to all play mummers, or we're going to all play Wardens of the Night or whatever. And then it's about expanding our turf as much as we can, or, like, fighting over, you know, like, okay, we're going to sacrifice this turf to the family, but that way we can seize this district from the circle or whatever. I think there's a lot of also potential in the idea that you kind of have to operate under the surface level, right? Like, you can't just be overt. You're not heroes by any stretch of the imagination. You don't get to bask in the limelight. I like to call you your bad guys that you can root for. Like, you operate outside the law. You are lawbreakers. You are criminals, right? You don't get the... There will never be the ticker tape parade for you. But you still got to do the job. You still got to go out there. And there's something appealing about that idea of being the underdog that I think is compelling about any game where you play, like, thieves, right? Any game where you're in this sort of genre. And I think that the combination of we're all outsiders and underdogs with we're all in these different factions, I think is really interesting, because you get that sense of we belong and that sense of camaraderie of like, okay, like we're all in this together and the whole city is against us, right? I think that's really interesting and compelling. And then, like, you know, the conflict between the cartels adds a little twist to that. So it's like, okay, we're all in this together except for those guys who are not in it for us as much as we're in it for us, right? So I find that really exciting, and like it makes it really easy to design like interesting twists on characters and scenarios.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How much fun has it been to work with Daniel Solis?
Oh, Daniel is amazing. So I like to say that Daniel takes my plain, dry Word documents and transforms them into a thing that you would actually want to own. He is spectacular. Daniel is a super talented game designer, amazing graphic designer, and layout guy. Working with Daniel has been a real pleasure. And if I don't know if you guys have seen this, but he has his own Kickstarter running right now for a card game called Trickster, which I backed, and I highly recommend you do as well, because Daniel makes good things.
Yeah.
But yeah, Daniel's been great. One of the things I did when I set out to make this product is, you know, it may, like, you go to the Kickstarter and you see, like, Scratchpad Publishing LLC. That's all smoke and mirrors. That's just me, right? Like, this is a one-man shop, and that's all for legal purposes, right? It's just me, and I knew that I'm not that guy that can do everything. Like, I know nothing about InDesign. I've never had to do any of that stuff, right? I can't draw a stick figure to save my life. So what I said was, you know, I don't want to put out something that is just, like, it's great game design, but it doesn't look very good or whatever, right? I want to put out something that is a really great product top to bottom. And what that means is going out and getting people who are doing great work already, right? And that's why I went and approached Joy, because I knew Joy could handle it and could make something that is more than just like, oh yeah, here's some cool fantasy art. Like, she could really bring a lot of character to these characters. And I went and got Daniel because I knew he would make everything look really nice and professional and clean and appealing and readable, right? My editor is Michelle Carter, who I worked with at Wizards of the Coast, right? And Michelle is amazing, and she has a great insights not only into the you know, like copy editing and stuff like that, but she finds rules issues, and she finds like, hey, this setting element doesn't make a lot of sense, or she'll flag things like, hey, you know, this would be a really great idea to introduce this particular story element, right? I'm like, oh, you're right, because you're an amazing editor, and I wouldn't have thought of that, right? So I've tried to surround myself with people who are super talented in the different things that they do, because at the end of the day, I want people to walk away with Dusk City Outlaws and say like, yep, I got a really quality product for my money, right? Like, it's a box set, it's really solid, but, you know, everything from graphic design, art, editing, layout, everything all is really good, because if one part falls down, it can kind of spoil the rest of it, right? So that's what I'm shooting for.
Yeah, I think it's really important, actually. So myself and my friend Matt are going to be kickstarting a game soon, and we had a meeting last week, and we were talking about, it's like, we want to put ourselves in the position to do what it is that we're passionate about and good at, and then we're going to try to surround ourselves with people who are passionate about, you know, the other things that we don't know how to do. And I think the way that you're kind of putting together Dusk City Outlaws is the same way, which is really commendable, the fact that you're like saying, you know, I am very good at the writing the setting, and I can do the rules, and it's really solid, but if I work with people who can, you know, really turn it up a notch with their illustration or with their design, and you're open to, you know, collaborating with them and meeting them part way, I think that it's only going to make the game, you know, that much better. And so I commend you for doing that, because a lot of people, I think, out the gate, if they're going to make, you know, if they're going to make their own setting and their own rules, would also kind of have this sort of
ego,
this ego about it. But it sounds like you're being very free with the creativity.
I mean, yes and no. Like, you can say it's ego, but it also could be just a desire to see what their vision, or see their vision through to the end, right? Like, and you know, a lot of people are multi-talented like that. They can do art and game design, right? Like, Daniel's a great example. Daniel Solis can do art and game design, right? And he could do graphic design and game design, right? I don't have one of those skills, so I have to lean on other people, because at the end of the day, I want this to be an awesome product. But if I could, like, if for some reason, like, I could do art, yeah, I might do it myself because I know what I want out of it.
Right.
And a lot of working with Joy has been, for example, has been me going to her with, like, here's what I want to communicate. Here's the tone or here's the theme. And then she comes back with her own spin on it. And that's great because I tend to be better when I collaborate with other people than if I try and do things entirely on my own, just, like, across the board. But I could see, like, I've also done all the game design myself. And I could have gone out and got other game designers to help me with that, but I knew what I wanted to accomplish. And at this point, it was just like, no, like, I'm going to try and do this myself because I think I've got a handle on it, right? So mm-hmm. I wouldn't necessarily call it ego so much as we all have different capabilities.
Yeah, I think what it comes down to is just having, like, the self-awareness and knowing that it's like, here's my strong suits, here's what I can really knock out of the park, and then here's what where I can bring other people in to sort of augment what I'm making.
That's what a good project manager does.
Right. What have you learned about your, you know, design process or yourself in doing this project of taking on sort of a project that's really that you have, you know, final say and full control over both the narrative and backstory and the mechanics? Is there any lessons that you've sort of in this, you know, time working on this game you've discovered about yourself?
I would say I sort of reinforced the fact that I need other people to help me with things, right? Like I've done a lot myself, but the game wouldn't exist without the help of a bunch of other people, right? Like, not just Daniel and Joy and Michelle, but also my developers, Dan and Caitlin, and my icon designer, Dan Jellin, who I also worked with at Wizards, right? And my two environment artists. Like, this game doesn't exist without a whole bunch of people pitching in, and it's one of those deals where, like, I have to recognize that, you know, I might have a vision for a thing, but that vision just stays up in my head if I don't reach out to other people. And so it's something I always kind of knew, but it's definitely been reinforced on the project. I think another thing I've learned is that there's a difference between having a vision for the setting and getting that out of the paper and selling that vision to other people. I don't think I'm very good at self-promotion in general. I think that, I always want to be like, oh, yeah, like, I designed this thing, it was pretty cool, but I don't want to take up too much of your time talking about it, right?
Yeah.
I'm not great at promoting it, and then, like, now with a Kickstarter, you have to. Right, like, you right. have to get your name out there, and I always feel so, like, pushy, like, oh, like, I'm bothering people or whatever, and everyone's like, no, you have to do this, man, you've got to go do this, right? And so one of the things I've learned is that it's real freaking hard to promote your stuff, especially if you're not used to having to do that, right? Because, you know, I advantage of working for a Wizards of the Coast or another company is that they have people that really specialize that and are really good at it, and so, like, I'm learning that it's I'm continuing to learn even today that it's really hard to excite people about something that they haven't played already or haven't seen other people play already. And so that's why I went to a lot of trouble to create the video of the people playing it down in Hollywood and the audio recordings of my friends up here playing it. And I'm going to be doing live streams because I want to get it in front of people. But, like, I'm sitting here today, this morning, I'm drinking my coffee, sitting here looking at my screen going, how the hell do I get people to talk about this game? Right? Yeah. Like, and the thing is, you got to play it in a lot of ways to be able to talk about it, right? And so I've got the print and play that you can download if you kickstart the game, but, like, even then, there's that barrier because you got to print it out, right? It is not yet the box that you pull off the shelf and can just play. You got to print it out, and you got to come up with some dice, and you got to get your friends together, right? Like, it's challenging. It really is to figure out how to go from, like, I think I had this cool idea, will you help me, to, like, and here is why you should, right?
Right. Yeah, I think that's a tough thing for, like, a lot of just creatives in general.
Yeah.
And you know, not that you need my permission, but I would give you permission as someone who is, you know, a large body of work, who started as, you know, a fan doing something they love, you know, was able to work for a company doing something they love, and now at the tail end of it is creating something, like, fully out of love for wanting to create, you know, their own world. I think that that's a story that, like, that people can get behind. And I don't think there's any shame in saying, hey, like, this is, you know, like you said on the Kickstarter, this is the first time that you're able to work on something that is, you know, that you create the setting and the rules for, and it's really yours. And I think that's, like, people can get behind that. People will rally behind that because A, you're an awesome guy, but B, you do awesome work. So I think that helps too.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And, you know, I I definitely have to look at it like a collaborative effort, because there's no, like I said, I can't make this game without Joy and Daniel and Dan and Caitlin and all those people, right? I also can't make it without people who actually want to play the game, right?
Right.
And who actually are interested in helping me bring this vision, like, to the table, right? And I think there's also, you know, it's in a genre that's had some recent successful games as well, right? Like, there's a couple of indie games that have come out or in the process of coming out or have kickstarted over the course of the last 3 or 4 years that I think you know, people are excited about. And like, now what I'm trying to do with this vision for like a bright, colorful, inviting, vivid game, it's a different vision, but like I'm still having to get that across to people, like, no guys, like here's what makes this one unique and different. And so like what I hope is that I can get that across to people, because I think that if people get this on the table, they're gonna see like why this is different and why it's exciting. And you know, I'd also like to keep doing this. I mean, you called it. You said here at the tail end. I certainly hope it's not the tail end of my independent design career. I hope it is just the beginning. But,
right. Yeah. Yeah.
You know, but the thing is, like, I would love it if, you know, this project ends up being something that, you know, produces a really high quality product, and then, you know, just like a Lords of Waterdeep, people have it out there on their shelves and show it to other people and are like, hey, let's play this game tonight because we're, you know, we're all together. We didn't prep for an RPG, but we want to play an RPG, right?
Right.
So, you know, I have these goals, but we'll see.
And then you get to make splat books forever?
No, actually, so it's funny you should bring that up. I was talking to somebody the other day, and they're like, oh, what are you going to do for supplements? I'm like, well, I'm trying to make this box set as comprehensive as possible so that you don't need a lot of supplements. It's also very, like, a lot of the world building is handed over to the players. But the other thing I'm doing with the Kickstarter is there's an add-on that you can get with the Kickstarter that is basically I'll give you all of my digital files. Like, I'll give you all my high-res images. I'll give you all my InDesign files, all my InDesign templates, so that if you want to create your own material, your own scenarios or your own, you know, cartels or your own specialties or whatever, you can do that, and they will look like the stuff that I created, right? Mm. And it will look like the stuff that Daniel ate. Like, basically, Daniel's going to create these templates, and then I'll turn them over to the people that back at that level so that they can make their own stuff. Because what I want is for people to take it and make it their own. And if that means they take it and they're like, yeah, I don't really care about this fantasy setting, I want to do it as a modern game, great. Like, have at it. Take the files, swap out that piece of art for a piece of modern art instead, and go nuts, right? Like, I want to empower people to take it and do what they want with it. This is not something that I feel like once I've created it that I need to maintain super tight control over, because that's not really what role-playing games are. Role-playing games are exercises in creativity, and you know, I think we've seen, like we were talking about earlier, like with D&D, everybody makes up their own adventures and their own campaigns. Like, I want people to do that with my game, right? Because that's what makes them fun.
See, the thing that I love about that, and again, see, the reason that your story is so cool is that, you know, in many ways, when you got your start in this industry, you were doing that. You were taking something someone else
sure.
made it and
yeah.
making it your own. And now, at the tail end, just kidding. right now with your recent project, like, you're still championing that type of spirit. And so, again, I think that this is like a reason that people are going to get behind this project, is because, you know, you are, like I mentioned at the very very beginning of the show, how, you know, social media and people can have the ability to make content now and do those things, kind of like how you started, and it's kind of coming full circle a little bit. You're that person, and I think a lot of people will really identify with that. And, you know, in the Kickstarter, if you back it, you do get the print and play, correct?
Yeah, if you back it right now, you can go immediately download the print and play, and it's pretty easy to get it to hit the table. The only tricky part is that the game comes with custom dice, so you have to either get some blank dice and mark them up, or if you don't have that, you have to get some D10s and D8s and do a little bit of, you know, interpretation. But yeah, you can start playing right away. Honestly, it's pretty much the full rules of the game as far as like everything you need to play, right? There's not a whole lot that's cut out. What I did cut out was a lot of the examples, just so that it wouldn't be quite so long. But it's basically the full rules of the game, minus like the campaign rules and the optional variant rules and the, you know, the weird like game hacks that I'm going to include if I have the space, right? A lot of the if I have the space comes down to, like, if we hit a certain stretch goal, I'll just add a bunch more pages to the book. That's one thing I'm doing with my stretch goals, is that if, you know, knock on wood, if the project funds, then every stretch goal feeds back into the game itself. So there's, like, everybody's copy of the game gets better if we hit stretch goals. And so, like, it'll be, like, adding pages, adding art, adding new components to the game, etc. Anyways, that's, I got way off track there, but
no, that's okay.
Yeah. Woo, anyhow.
So so definitely if you're listening to this and, you know, if the idea of, like, you know, a fantasy heist setting and game with sort of narrative driven dice mechanics, if you're still on the fence, go back to Kickstarter, toss a couple bucks Rodney's way, he's earned it, and check out the print and play, try it out, and then if they do like it, what sort of levels do you have going on in the Kickstarter campaign?
What's the best level?
The best level? No. So I actually wanted to have a really simple level, so there's only three levels. There is the basic level, which is the PDF, right? Like, you get the PDFs. Again, you can print it out and play. It's a little tricky without the dice, but you could do it, right? And I figure there's a lot of people out there that just want to read it or adapt it to different settings or to different games or whatever, and that's fine. That's what the PDFs are for. The base game, the box set that you get, like the sort of core game, is the middle tier. And then the top tier is the deluxe set, and that includes the base game plus the three add-ons that I have, which are the digital creator pack that I was talking about, a set of metal coins, working with the people at Campaign Coins. Yeah, the basically Campaign Coins is producing metal coin versions of the tokens that come on a punch out cardboard sheet with the game, and it's enough to replace the cardboard tokens, so you play with metal. Actually, hang on 1 second, this is video, right?
Yeah.
Literally today, as soon as I came in the house,
unboxing
the sample
exclusive
coins, the sample coins had arrived from Campaign Coins. I'll pull one of these out. So yeah, you get a set of metal coins. They are they replace all the cardboard tokens in the game, and then you also get the campaign pack, which I'll explain in a second. But let's see if we can get this on the video here, right?
Ooh,
so, yeah. So it's sort of goldish. It's, you know, sort of a goldish color with blue lacquer on it. This is the influence token. This is the resource that you spend to sort of bend the narrative as the players. And then let's see if I can pull out one of these cool ones here. Yeah. So I've talked a lot about the resource that the judge has called heat that they use to introduce complications. So
right.
heat coins will come in two denominations. There's the 5 coin denomination. Again, it's this sort of a silver color with red lacquer on it. And then I've got the one heat denomination, and the one heat will actually fit inside the center ring here, so they stack really easily.
Neat. Thank you very much, by the way, for describing the visual look of those, because we do release audio as well,
and right.
That's very professional.
Yeah,
that's how you know you're dealing with a pro.
Yeah, it's the heat coins are silver with red lacquer on them, and I think, like, I love the way the lacquer makes the numbers on this and everything pop. It's really awesome.
Yeah, they look great.
Yeah, and so then you also get the campaign pack. The campaign pack comes with extra copies of all of the cartel sheets so that you can play that game where you're all part of the same cartel. Like, we're all mummers, or we're all wardens of the night, or whatever. It comes with the Turf Wars supplement, which is the thing that you need or that you'll use to play that kind of game. It comes with the judge screen, which is a 4-panel GM screen, sort of low landscape format GM screen. It's got full color city art on the player facing side, and then a bunch of reference on the judge facing side. Makes it a lot easier to run the game. It comes with an extra set of advantage and challenge dice so that you don't have to, you know, pass them around. And I think that is it, although that, again, stretch goals may change things.
And love.
It comes with lots of love.
Yeah, that sounds awesome. Again, I would encourage folks to go check out the campaign. It's Dusk City Outlaws. You know, check out the video, look at the art, you know, and, you know, back it for a couple bucks, download the print and play and you know, read through it and check it out. And I think that you'll be sold on it, because it sounds pretty awesome. And again, I as someone who struggles nowadays to be able to get, you know, solid campaigns of games going, I really cherish the idea of a product, you know, that's well-crafted, that I can pull out and give me a role-playing experience. Like, that, you know. So yeah. I think that's a really good thing too.
I hope so. That's what I'm going for.
Be the gamma world you want to see in the world.
Yeah. So thank you very much, Rodney, for coming on the show, our first guest on video on YouTube.
This has been super exciting.
So besides the Dusk City Outlaws Kickstarter, which people should certainly go to, and down below we'll put the show notes so people can check that out, where can people find you on social media if they have questions about any of this stuff?
Yeah, so you can either follow me. My Twitter handle is Antarian Ranger, which is a Star Wars Expanded Universe reference because I'm a huge nerd. Or you can follow the LLC that I've set up, Scratchpad Pub. It's Scratchpad Pub, all one word, is the Scratchpad Publishing Twitter feed. Or you can go to scratchpadpublishing.com or dusticityoutlaws.com, and there's a contact form in there, or you know, social media links as well.
Awesome. Well, once again, thank you very much. Check out Dusk City Outlaws when you get a chance, and we'll see you next time.
Thanks a lot, guys. It's been a pleasure.
Rodney Thompson is one of the nicest guys.
Yeah.
He's so nice.
Yeah, he's so expressive.
He is. And you can tell at the end, I'm glad that we talked to him a little bit about his plan for releasing all of that content, because I really think that tells so clearly the story of, like, you know, this person who was really fascinated with telling stories, was telling stories on their own for free, mm-hmm. you know, got noticed, started doing it for money, and now was able to, you know, put their own creation out after putting all the work in for other people and working with, you know, these great, you know, organizations. So now he finally gets to make his own, tell his own story, which is really cool. So that has been our show. Thank you very much for listening and for watching. If you have been listening on iTunes, we really appreciate it. You can, of course, subscribe on iTunes. Just press the subscribe button. Helps us out on the iTunes algorithms. If you want to give us a review, you can do that as well. If it's a 5-star review, Dell will read it on the air in the voice of your choice. If you're watching us on YouTube, we really appreciate you as well. Like the video. You can comment down below if you have questions for us or Rodney. We can pass it on to him and get you some answers. Or, of course, if you want to see more episodes like this, click that subscribe button and press that little bell down there. Typically, we tell you what we're excited about, but we're excited about Dusk City Outlaws. Check it out on Kickstarter. It looks really awesome. I'm super excited for it as a fan of shows like Leverage and Ocean's 11, and it's that fantasy take that I think gives it just enough of a spin to make it really unique. So definitely check that out and support Rodney. Like I said, he's a great guy. On that note, you may now add 1,000 XP to your character sheets, and we will see you next time. Bye-bye. I did that. The wave thing is a new thing that I'm going to do now.
Are you?
No.